स्टार्ट इट इज ऑब्वियस दैट वन ऑफ द मेजर प्रॉब्लम्स वी हैव टू फेस इज अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट इट इज ए टेरिफिक ह्यूमन प्रॉब्लम व्हिच वी कैनॉट इग्नोर मियरली गिविंग सम काइंड ऑफ ऑक्यूपेशन टू ए लार्ज number of persons does not ultimately increase employment or lessen unemployment. We delude ourselves if we think so. An honorable member of this house remarked outside the house, I believe that a good method of giving employment to a large number of people would be by abolishing the railways. In that event, there will probably be some kind of hand carts. If many people will be pushing them, some no doubt will be sitting in them. That would be a completely wrong approach to this problem. Employment comes through newer and more effective means of wealth production. The whole experience of the past 200 years shows that it comes with the growth of technological methods. It is true that technological growth often leads to human misery, but precautions can be taken. Do not imagine that minus technological progress, we are going to deal with the problem of unemployment. We cannot. Every country which boasts of full employment today is a country which is technologically advanced. Every country which is not technologically advanced has unemployment or underemployment. Therefore, if India is to advance, India must advance in science and technology, and India must use the latest techniques, always keeping in view, no doubt, that in doing so, the intervening period, which always occurs, must not cause unhappiness or misery. We have to provide for that even at the cost of progress, because that is no progress which brings suffering and misery in its train. Now, we have been planning more or less methodically for the last 7 years or so. As we have tried to plan, we have, if I may say so, with all respect, grown a little more expert in planning. We are getting more educated in this process. We have had the advantage of discussing these matters with many experts in India and elsewhere, realizing that the problems will have to be solved by us, not by the experts. But the experts throw light on different aspects of the problems and make us think, and they point out our mistakes. So, gradually, through painful process of thought, we have proceeded along this path of planning. We want to pursue it further. Even people who do not believe in planning, they are becoming fewer and fewer. People who believe in what is called free enterprise are gradually realizing the limitations of free enterprise. In a country like India, situated as we are, there can be no free enterprise in the absolute sense. In our circumstances, I am quite certain that with an unplanned free enterprise approach, we cannot make any progress at all. If there is any progress, it will be lopsided. We can put up factories here and there, but it will result only in riches here and greater poverty there. That is not what India aims at. Further, the total wealth production of the country will not be as great as through planned effort. That is a patent fact requiring no proof. The essence of planning is to find the best way to utilize all resources of manpower, of money, and so on. And the essence of free enterprise is to leave these things more or less to chance. Well, if chance is a more satisfactory way of dealing with the problems of life than carefully thought out methods, then of course there need be no planning at all. It means trusting to luck. It is the old idea of fate. This is no good. All over the world, the idea of planning is being appreciated more and more. For an underdeveloped country, particularly, planning is essential. It may not be so necessary in developed countries. They can perhaps do without it, but there is no other way but planning for an underdeveloped country like ours. Again, India is part of a region, South Asia, or a good part of Asia, which is more or less underdeveloped. As a matter of fact, even the progress and development of India necessitates the development of the countries around India. I do not mean to say that we cannot develop unless those countries also develop, or that we should interfere with them. My point is that it is in our interest that other countries also develop. To think that the development of other countries comes in our ways is true only in a colonial pattern of society, where we want to buy cheap raw materials from a country under our influence and impose our goods in a protected market. That does not apply to free countries. It is in our interest, politically and economically, that other countries in Asia and Africa should also develop. We cannot, unfortunately, help them much because our resources are limited, but tried our fast to help them in their development program.